Good afternoon, everybody. Oh, I knew I'd get a muted response since the end of the day, I know. So a huge thank you for coming. And a big thank you, of course, to Cambridge for inviting me to come to this beautiful city once again, and to get with you, to work with you, educational leaders, whom I normally don't work with as frequently as I do with teachers. So it's a real pleasure to have met so many of you already. Okay, so my talk, as you know, is on artificial intelligence. I have written quite extensively, as Matt said, in the field of learning technologies, as you can see, but my focus has shifted over the 15 or so years that I've been writing about technology. The field has changed immensely, and learning technologies have changed immensely. And of course, the latest kid on the block is this one, artificial intelligence, which I think really has had the effect of focusing our minds as teachers and educational leaders on the potentials and also the dangers of learning technologies in the classroom. My own take on learning technologies has become increasingly critical over the years, hence the title of this talk. We're going to be taking a critical perspective on some of the issues around learning technologies, as you'll see. This is what the session looks like. There's going to be a little introductory bit, but we're going to look at three main questions or three issues or three areas that I think are important in learning technologies. It's just three out of many, many more because I only have an hour, probably lucky for you. I could go on quite at length. We're just going to look at three that I think are particularly interesting for educational leaders and of course for teachers. I'll summarize then with some ethical pathways of how to deal with these issues and some takeaways. And then at the end, there will be a resources slide with some of the key links that I'll flag up as we go along. And the overall aim you can see down there at the bottom of the slide. So let's get cracking. I'm going to start by telling you about Misaki. Now, Misaki had the ideal romantic relationship. This is the boyfriend you can see over there. Absolutely wonderful relationship. Now, he was a successful businessman, which required a lot of travel. But thankfully, through mobile devices, they were able to keep in contact, I mean, all the time, every day, several times a day. And he was such a wonderful boyfriend that he would message her, send her voice messages first thing in the morning, at night, during the day. He'd remind her, you know, ask what she'd had for lunch or for dinner, remind her to eat healthily. He would even tell her stories or read poetry, in fact, via the mobile at night so that she could go to sleep listening to the sound of his voice. It was all absolutely wonderful. And then one day, Misaki woke up and the boyfriend was gone. She was absolutely devastated. What had happened? Well, basically, the company that had produced the app, which was called Him, had closed the app. So he wasn't a real boyfriend at all. He was an AI chatbot. Whoa. Yes. And some people would probably think that sounds like quite a nice relationship to have. I mean, you never actually have to pick those dirty socks off the floor or listen to the snoring. But Misaki and thousands of women all over Asia were absolutely devastated when the app was closed. There was no explanation from the company. The app was pulled, and that was the end of the relationship for her. Okay, so there we go. The story of Misaki and the boyfriend. And here is the app, which was called Him. So it's a real app, and this is a real story. And Misaki really was heartbroken. Now, I think the story is interesting for several reasons. First of all, it shows how we tend to anthropomorphize. In other words, we kind of project human characteristics onto things. For example, I had a camper van, which I loved. It was like a part of the family. And when we sold it, I was devastated. So you can imagine when you're using an app and you're interacting with it in a very human-like way, we tend to anthropomorphize even more because we are, in a way, interacting with another being, although perhaps not a human being. That's one interesting part of it. The other part of it is how Him, the app, fulfilled a real emotional need for Misaki. The fact that she and so many other people like her were so heartbroken when he died, shows the very real social emotional bonds that were formed for her. Now, we might sit back and think, well, this is crazy, I would never do that. If you do want to, by the way, here are some apps you could try out. But you never know. But there are millions of people around the world who have relationships with so-called AI companions. And these are some AI companion apps. The one on the left, Replica, was launched in 2017 and is one of the ones that has been around on the market the longest. And these are just another two that I found in my my app store. Not that I've tried them out. I'm tempted frequently.
True.
But there you go. So, interesting, huh? If we extrapolate from this, though, and think about the implications of it, well, the first thing is, for Misaki, obviously, her digital companion, maybe it was better than nothing. It was better than her not having a boyfriend. It worked for her, having this AI companion. But what happens when there's a point at which it's not just that you don't want the real-life boyfriend, the AI boyfriend is a lot better, and it's easier to have relationships. And this is a real issue that is confronting social scientists at the moment. So Sherry Turkle, who's a social scientist from MIT, wrote a wonderful book in 2013 called Alone Together. And she was talking about our online relationships, like online communication with messaging and SMS and apps and so on. And she was also talking about social robots. So she was writing over a decade ago. And she talks about this. She says, digital companionship may be better than nothing, but what happens when it becomes better than anything? And we prefer robotic relationships. And she calls this the robotic moment, the moment in which we switch from interacting with human beings, and that's okay, but we switch to preferring to interacting with non-human beings. And that's an interesting thought, isn't it? Because if we think about ourselves as teachers and educational leaders, does that mean that it's possible for our students to reach a robotic moment? So like Misaki's relationship with her boyfriend, why couldn't a student have an AI relationship with a teacher? No? Sounds like it might be easier, actually, or not, depending on how you see it. So the question here really is, could automated digital teachers replace human teachers? And this is a question for you. And I'd like you to try out the poll, which is in the app, the conference app. And we're going to switch to the poll mode now so that here we can see exactly what the percentages are.
No, I hope.
Okay, so we can see in real time as you're voting in the poll, we can see how the percentages are changing. So at the moment we have no. You're all feeling that no, that we won't be replaced by digital teachers. Some of you are not sure. Okay, that it's remaining pretty constant, so you all disagree with that. Okay, I have to agree with you. I don't think we will be replaced, and there's a couple of reasons why. There's a couple of implications, I think, for us. Can we remove the poll and go back to the slides? Yeah, okay, we're back. All right, why are teachers so worried about being replaced by digital stuff? It's a very, very real fear, and I'm sure you've either felt it yourself, if you're a teacher, or your teachers are feeling this at the moment. It's a very, very natural reaction to have with this fast-paced change that we're living through, and this, you know, suddenly amazing generative AI that seems to be doing a pretty good job of interacting with our students. Well, the first thing I would say is that we need to learn to resist the hype around AI. And of course, hype is not just around AI. It's been around all sorts of learning technologies for, you know, hundreds of years, in fact, not just around digital technologies. So the idea that the latest software or hardware is somehow the thing that's going to solve our lives and going to, you know, make English teaching, you know, brilliant forevermore. It's exactly the same story with AI. We're seeing a lot of hype. And to be able to resist that hype, we need to develop some critical digital literacies. Now, in terms of AI hype, there's a number of reasons that we have this particular, you know, flood of hyped up expectations. The first one is the idea of hype for economic benefit. So let's not forget that there are some very large tech companies behind these new generative AI tools, and that their goal is to make some money. They may improve educational outcomes along the way, but I don't think Elon Musk is up at night worrying about your students learning English, okay? These are large companies interested in making money. So this is hype for profit, and we see this around educational products frequently, because the companies behind them, in this case Google and OpenAI and all the rest of them, stand to make quite a lot of money. The other one is that the product, in this case AI, is positioned as essential. It's essential for your business, it's essential for language learning. Your students are never going to learn unless they have it. And again, we see this through the long history of digital technologies. We saw the same thing with interactive whiteboards, those of you who remember that. So that's another reason for hype around AI, this idea of techno-solutionism. You may have heard this term before, the idea that technology solves education in some way. And a third way is an over-reliance on data-driven views of learning. Now, data is extremely useful, don't get me wrong. Data is very useful, but it doesn't tell the whole story. Numbers can't tell the whole story, and I'm going to give you some examples of how they can't. I've got this paper because I want to share a study with you, and I need to have the numbers correct, so it's about data. This is a study that was carried out in Princeton University in 2020. They had teams of AI researchers and data scientists, and they got data from, how many? 4,000 families. So students in 4,000 different families, 13,000 data points in total, taken over a period of 15 years. All right, so we're talking about a whole range of, you know, numbers, basically. And the researchers and the data scientists need to come up with some kind of statistical model that could predict the longer term outcomes for these particular students. So for example, they needed to look at, try and predict things like long-term future exam results. How were these kids going to do in exams, right? You could base it on all of this data. And things like perseverance with school. Would they remain in education? Would they drop out? What sort of, you know, achievement levels would they have? And in fact, none of the teams were able to come up with a working statistical model. Because, of course, this was done retrospectively, right? So they were looking back at 15 years of data. They knew what the outcomes were. But the models couldn't predict the actual outcomes, if that makes sense. There's a couple of reasons for that, of course, because our decision-making is based on our personal experience. We change our minds. Reflection is going to affect our choices and outcomes. Empathy, emotion, imagination, all of those things were not reflected in the data points. And then, of course, social and environmental factors. You can't predict those in the data either. They can very easily change for individuals. And this is why I think it's so important for us to be developing critical digital literacies, our own as leaders, and of course, our teachers and our teacher educators, and in fact, everybody, our students, of course, as well. To be able to do that well, I think we need to look at what research actually says. So if we look here, what does the research say? Well, the first thing is that the effect of human teachers is key in terms of successful learning. So maybe you could have an AI app, but it's never going to be as effective as the kind of empathy and the connection and the collaboration that you get from a human teacher. And there is research to back this up. So that's the way it is. We do have a key role as teachers, which is good news for us. I think chatbot research is interesting, though, because one of the learning technologies or technologies that does hold potential for language learning are chatbots. And there's research dating back decades into the use of chatbots. Now, you'll know that chatbots have improved, right? We have the boyfriend app. He's much better than he would have been 10 years ago. Chatbot apps beforehand were run on very limited forms of AI called rules-based AI, which is basically, you know, responding to pre-programmed prompts and so on, so you can't really go off script with the old-fashioned chatbots. But the new generative AI chatbots, of course, respond much more realistically to conversation, as you know, if you've tried something like ChatGPT. It can follow twists and turns in the conversation much better than the old form could. So, you know, chatbots do perhaps hold some promise for language learning, but that doesn't mean that they should replace teachers. They can simply supplement what happens in the classroom. So I think it is our job as teachers teacher trainers and educational leaders to tell our students about these and to encourage them to try them out of class. Maybe not the AI companions, but certainly the language learning chatbots, and I'll come back to those in a little while. Okay, that's enough numbers and data and studies. I'd like to do something completely different now. If you have a piece of paper, you could do this, or you could just imagine this in your mind. I want you to imagine an image of a scientist. If you want to draw one, that's fine. Okay, if you prefer not to draw, you can close your eyes or not, but create a mental image of a scientist. Okay, I want you to visualize this scientist, decide what they're wearing and where they are. So what do they look like? What are they wearing and where are they? Okay, and those of you who are drawing, lovely. And then I'd like you to just share your drawing or your mental image with the person next to you. Describe what you saw or show the picture that you've drawn. All right, so just as a matter of interest, how many of you actually drew the picture? Could you hold up your hand? How many drew? Okay, just a few of you. All right. So, how many of you, just hold up your hand if this is true for you, how many of your scientists were in a laboratory or something like that, like a professional setting? Okay, not everybody, most of you, yeah? Were they wearing a white coat or similar uniform? Yeah, okay, right. If your scientist was male, hold up your hand. Okay, so to get a clearer idea, if your scientist was female, hold up your hand. Much for you. What about the rest of you? Okay, well, I mean, it could be whatever you like. All right, well, talking about AI, funny you should mention that. Here we go. These are some images of scientists that I generated using AI. In this specific case, I used MS Copilot Designer, and my prompt was, generate an image of a scientist in a white coat holding a test tube. So you can see mine are all in a kind of professional setting, much like yours were. But look at the gender representation, kind of similar to what we had here. Also look at the race representation. I did this in February 2024. Okay, I did it again a couple of months later with the same tool, and this is what I got.
Oh, it's me.
And then I did it just before the talk, a week or so ago. Pretty similar, isn't it, across the board. You can notice the gender representation doesn't really change that much, and also the race representation is interesting, isn't it? Yeah, so are you familiar with the Draw a Scientist experiments? If you've heard of these, could you put up your hand? A couple of you, okay, yeah. So this is a wonderful thing. This was a science experiment that started, again, I need to get my numbers right, 1966 to 1977. So during an 11-year period, primary school teachers in the US went into classes and they asked primary school children to draw pictures of scientists. And then they collected all the drawings together. And they collected about 20,000 drawings over, no, sorry, 5,000 drawings over that period of 11 years. And they looked at the gender representation. And they found of 5,000, how many, all of them, do you think were pictures of female scientists? Just give me a number. 50, 100, 1,000. Okay, 6. All right, so 28. Less than 1%.
What?
All drawn by girls. All right, so this is now 1977. In 2018, so fairly recently, there was a meta-analysis done of the Draw a Scientist experiments because they've carried on since 1966 up to the present day. It's a really interesting long-term experiment. This meta-analysis looked back, and what they found was that by 1985, about 33% of girls were drawing female scientists. Now, they only looked at the drawings done by girls, which may sound weird, but what they found consistently from 1966 to today is that boys, 9 out of 10 boys, so 90% of boys, draw male scientists. So they kind of took them out. They weren't interested that much in what boys were drawing. That was fairly predictable and hadn't changed. But they wanted to look at how girls representations of scientists had changed. So they found from less than 1% in 1977, or across that period, by 1985 it was 33% of girls were drawing female scientists. And interestingly, by 2016, 58% of girls were drawing scientists. So there's clearly a change here over time. Interesting, isn't it? And then you think about why, well, you know, cultural representations. You know, now, these days in the movies, you know, you watch American movies, you will tend to see a female doctor. And yeah, there's much more gender representation in these kinds of professions. These days it's changed. But this is the finding that I found most interesting in the meta study, right? So they looked at age differences. They've been doing it with primary school children and secondary school kids over this period of time, since 1977. Six-year-old girls, so the youngest girls, 70% of those draw female scientists. Okay, so I'll let you think about it. Six-year-old girls, 70% are drawing female scientists, 30% drawing male. 16-year-old girls, okay, we've got 60% for six-year-olds. Do you think that the 16-year-olds are drawing more or fewer female scientists? Yes, it's fewer. Well done. Yeah, 25%. It's a massive, massive difference, isn't it, from 70 to 25. I found that extraordinary. And I thought, what does that tell us? It tells us all sorts of interesting things about education and women and how they perceive themselves within the education system. But that's probably a whole separate talk, so we'll leave that right there. It's very, very interesting stuff. So again, let's extrapolate. In your roles as educational leaders, clearly representation is an issue in generative AI. We've just seen some, and you can see it very clearly in images. It's also obvious in other forms of AI-generated content, for example, in voice recognition. So voice recognition apps have traditionally discriminated against non-native speakers. They tend to be very normative because they're based on models, let's call them, of American, British, New Zealand, etc., accents as a standard. This has changed with generative AI, and there are movements now to create voice recognition apps for language practice based on large data sets of non-native speaker accents. There's a chatbot called Speak, which is based on non-native speaker accents, and another one called Elsa. And I've tried them out. I mean, they seem to be okay. I don't know. But you could try them as well. They're worth looking into. Anyway, our next poll question. Could you go back to the poll if you didn't answer it before? Have a look at it now. Okay, so this is interesting. You do see this raising awareness of bias as an important part of your jobs. That's fascinating. Thank you very much. Okay, if we could take the poll away. Okay, so we've got a huge agreement there. And what are the implications? Well, I think that you can go into your schools with the draw scientists experiments. I think that would be so interesting to do at school level. If you're an academic leader for many schools, you could do it across many schools. And if you teach young learners or your school teaches young learners and adolescents, do it across the age groups and see what you get. It would be so interesting to do. And you could most likely contribute to the Draw a Scientist experiments. I'm going to give you a link on the resources slide to some more information about those experiments, by the way. So I think it's a very easy to do way of raising awareness around bias. It really is. It's kind of concrete. You can see it. But slipping back again, as educational leaders, bias in general is often reflected in educational technologies. And again, we need to be able to ask ourselves if there are potential biases in the educational technologies we're bringing into schools. Let me give you an example. There's so many. I've got a huge, huge pile here. Let me see. Well, I talked about the speech recognition ones. Another one is this idea of GPT detectors. Have you heard of these? And a big concern for teachers is that their students will use something like ChatGPT to write essays. And there are so-called GPT detectors out there, which means you could run the essay, a student essay, through this program, and it kind of spots whether it's been put together by something like ChatGPT or whether it's been written by a student itself. And they've done research into this, and what they find is that the GPT direct detectors falsely identify, again, language learners' essays as written by GPT. So in other words, native speakers' essays written by GPT get passed, but if you're using GPT as a non-native speaker, this is so confusing. You know what I mean? A real written essay by a non-native speaker, okay, not written by ChatGPT, they're a real thing. Run that through a detector, and the GPT detector will say it has been written, right?
Yeah.
Okay, anyway, they're full of bias, this is it. And what the companies do is that they themselves say, oh, okay, well, and the small print on the web page says, by the way, this is not 100% reliable. In fact, it's like 20% reliable. So if you are bringing educational technologies into your institution as educational leaders, you need to be asking questions about the possible biases that are baked into these technologies. That's what I'm trying to say. Okay, let's move on to another area, though, which I think is also pretty fascinating. Now, this is a report that was written by Human Rights Watch in 2022, fairly recently. And what they did was they looked at the educational technologies that had come into institutions because of COVID. And I'm sure this was your case as well. When you all had to move online, you probably had to start using technologies that you may not have used before. And technology companies were very helpful, weren't they? Many of them were offering free things that you could then use. Now, this report, what they did was they looked at 49 countries, possibly your country, 49 of them, and they looked at the educational technology products that the governments of those 49 countries had said, yes, sure, we endorse these, you're allowed to use these products. And state schools and private schools across in these countries use these educational technology projects during COVID. Now, 164 educational technology products were analyzed, and of those, 146 had shared data about the students, so children's personal data, with 199 advertising technology companies. So let me run those numbers past you again. 164 products, of which 146 had collected student data and sold it to almost 200 educational advertising companies, okay? That's pretty shocking. In fact, the report, I'm gonna have to quote it to you because when I read this report, I found it so extraordinary. I'm gonna quote, this is from the report itself. It says, these products, so these are the products taking the kids' data. These products monitored or had the capacity to monitor children, in most cases secretly and without the consent of children or their parents, in many cases harvesting data on who they are, where they are, what they do in the classroom, who their family and friends are, and what kind of devices their families could afford for them to use. Children, parents, and teachers were largely kept in the dark about these data surveillance practices. The report finds that governments failed to protect children's right to education. That's pretty damning, isn't it? That's quite heavy. That's 94 countries really failing in their duty to protect children's data. I find that extraordinary, that finding. The link for this report, by the way, is there if you want to have a look at the original. All right. There are many issues around data and data protection and AI. The first is this increasing datafication of education. In other words, increasing amounts of student data being taken with and in some cases without permission, but also with. And this is just increasing. And sure, some data is useful, but you at least need to ask people if you can take the data. And if it's children's data, the parents need to know and permissions need to be given. So we have this datafication. This is an important area. It's not going away. The next one is this idea of surveillance capitalism. This is a term you've probably come across. It was coined by Shoshana Zuboff in 2019. And basically what she's talking about is when you sort of buy something, let's say you buy a car, those companies will often have access to your data. You don't realize just by buying the product, you have given them access. So car companies are an interesting one. I know I'm connected to education, but I think an interesting test case, because by buying your new, you know, fancy Tesla or whatever it is, you're plugging your smartphone into the dashboard or, you know, to play your tunes as you drive. And what you're doing is you're giving these companies access to your contacts, to your photos, all of the stuff. It's just happening, right? You've given this permission by buying the product. And this is what she means by surveillance capitalism. There's also, you know, your route. The route that you drive home, maybe you drive through a dangerous area in your city. Well, suddenly, the car company can sell this data to insurance companies. Insurance companies can have a look at you and your car and say, they're driving through that neighborhood. Let's put the premiums up. This is actually happening in the States. Not in Europe, as far as I know, where we have slightly tighter laws. But that's also kind of, you know, stuff that we need to know about and think about. The idea of data resignation there is this idea of the kind of increasing datification of education. Well, what do students think about this? A lot of research looks at the data that's collected and what it sort of says. There's many ways to interpret it. But not many researchers ask students what they think. So there was an interesting study last year, 2023, three secondary schools in Australia. They carried out some you know, interviews and so on with the students and asked them what they thought about the fact that the school was collecting all of this data through the LMS, through various ways. And basically, they found this, that the kids were resigned to having their data collected. And they also used, the researchers came up with the term surveillance realism. This idea of surveillance is just, you know, that's the way it is. There's nothing we can do about it. So there was this feeling of kind of hopelessness almost, or inability to be able to confront us, and there's nothing we can do anyway. We're students at this school. So, and then the last point here is transparency. And basically there are calls for transparency that all products, cars, educational data, whatever, we need to know what's being collected and why and what's happening to it. If it's going to third parties, are we okay with that? Are the students okay with it? This idea of transparency. You know, there's this constant fight between regulators and tech companies who don't want to say what they're doing with data or what data they're collecting. And then on the other side, you have regulators saying, well, we need to know. So this is going on. So the argument, of course, is, no, we can't tell you what we're doing because then we lose our competitive edge. This hasn't been resolved yet, although there are some regulations in place, and I'll give you some links to some of that a little later. Anyway, let's go back to us, though. Again, as educational technology leaders, we have a statement there. I mean, I think, obviously, your institution needs to be legal and ethical, of course, otherwise you break the law. What do you think about this last one? So can we start the polls? Put the poll up and see what happens. You'll notice that the wording of the question here is that an educational leader's job must include acting to protect student data. Acting. Not just thinking about or understanding. Okay. Well, nobody said no. All right. Yes. I mean, I would say yes, it definitely is part of your job. And we'll look in a second at how we can do that. Can we go back to the slides, Q? All right. So, what does that mean? Of course, training teachers in the ethical use of students' data. Now, you know, if you're using an LMS, for example, or educational technology products, often your teachers can't control, right? You click on the terms of service and so on, and that's sort of, in a way, out of the teacher's hands. But so let's go back to the first point. Teachers are manipulating some learner data. So do you remember as a teacher you would pass, with your adult learners, pass a piece of paper around the room, get everybody to write their phone number, so you could all, or their email, so that you can email them stuff. This is against the law under GDPR, which is General Data Protection Regulations in the EU. It is against the law to do this. You cannot collect this. Your school administration can collect students' phone numbers, emails, and so on for administrative purposes, but a teacher cannot do this. You cannot pass that piece of paper around the room anymore. So teachers need to know this, right? It needs to be very, very, you know, clear what's okay and what's not. The second point, we've kind of talked about this, that when you're procuring, when you're buying educational technology for your institution, you need to be asking questions around this. What's happening with the data? What data is being collected? Where's it going? And if those governments and those schools had done that during COVID, maybe all of that data would not have been sold to the 199 advertising companies. Of course, what are the right questions? In the resources slide, there's a link to the Institute for Ethical AI from the University of Buckingham. They have a list of questions to ask educational vendors at the procurement stage, and I'll give you a link to that. So there are guidelines and examples that you could use as an educational leader. The third point there is, of course, institutional guidelines within your own institution. And there are many, 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 many examples out there. And again, on the resources slide, there's an example. There are hundreds of examples. You can look for examples at primary level, secondary level, university level, college level, whatever. But I've given you one that you could have a look at. So you don't need to reinvent the wheel on producing guidelines for your institution, which I think you need to do. All right, let's summarize some of our takeaways so that we have time for questions. The first one is this. I think this fear that teachers have of being replaced by AI as educational leaders, it, you know, behooves us to go and talk to our teachers about this and kind of demystify the hype a little bit, which I hope I've done with you a little bit. This is the second takeaway. We've talked about this. I think these can be useful, and research shows that they can be useful. Chatbots out of class can be useful for language learners. For some, maybe not everybody loves them, but some people do, and they do find them useful. Okay, here's a third one. And there at the end, through TD, teacher development. So to be teacher development sessions, you could do a draw the scientist experiment with your teachers and see what they come up with, and then they could do the same with their students, for example. There's a fourth one.
Good.
Okay. And a fifth one. Well, I think we have a sixth. Oh, no, we don't. We have five. So I talked about some of these resources that I think you will find useful. The first one is the book from which many of these ideas and studies and so on I've drawn from the research I did for the book to share with you today. There's plenty more in the book itself. Should be out by December, we're hoping, a couple of months. This is a very nice little clear explanation of the draw a scientist experiments. This is the one, the ethical framework. These are where you can find a section on questions to ask educational technology vendors at procurement stage. And that's pretty useful. It's broken down into sections. The Russell Group of Universities, these are just guidelines for students and staff using AI at university level. But again, if you search online, you'll find for primary level and for secondary level. And then this is something fairly recent that's come through from UNESCO, this idea of competency framework, so AI literacy, and the kinds of competencies that are needed by learners and by teachers. And they divide it into two sections, competencies for learners and competencies for students. Again, this one well worth a look. And then just yesterday, actually, I met here somebody who's also from Spain. I'm based in Spain, Scott Markham, where is he? There he is. Scott is he leads one of the language teacher schools associations in Spain, and they have put together some guidelines for language schools, using it in Spain, but of course it's relevant to any language schools, and he has a version in English and a version in Spanish, and it has a SWOT analysis, the kinds of questions that you as an institution could ask to do a SWOT analysis in terms of your own AI readiness. That makes sense. If you'd like a copy of that, then find Scott. Scott, you want to just put up your hand so people can see who you are? It's very short and very clear, so I recommend that. If you'd like to have a look, it might help you, again, as an institutional leader, think about institutional readiness. Okay. Before we get to the questions, I want to leave you with what's coming in terms of AI. In fact, what I'm going to show you is already here. And we'll talk about this after you've seen the video. So I think I can launch the video. Let's try. Okay. So this is a robot called Figure. This is Figure sort of point one. Figure 02 has already come out. Point one's pretty interesting though, and it's a collaboration between Figure, which is a robotics company, and OpenAI, who of course are the developers of ChatGPT. So it's that kind of relationship between robotics and ChatGPT, which we all knew was coming, and here it is, so you can see it in action.
Hey, Figure One, what do you see right now?
I see a red apple on a plate in the center of the table, a drying rack with cups and a plate, and you standing nearby with your hand on the table.
Great, can I have something to eat?
Sure thing.
Great. Can you explain why you did what you just did while you pick up this trash?
On it. So I gave you the apple because it's the only edible item I could provide you with from the table.
Great. So based on the scene right now, where do you think the dishes in front of you go next?
The dishes on the table, like that plate and cup, are likely to go into the drying rack next.
Great, can you put them there?
Of course.
All right, so how do you think you did?
I think I did pretty well. The apple found its new owner, the trash is gone, and the tableware is right where it belongs.
I agree. Thanks, Figure One.
You're welcome. If there's anything else you need help with, just let me know.
Okay, so, you know, this is already with us. I'm already seeing the potential of the boyfriend app. And this, the washing up would get done for a start. Be wonderful. This is interesting. I mean, I guess we all end up speaking American English, as I can see from that. And I also find myself when I'm watching that thinking, I wonder if the guy asking the questions is actually the AI, because he's also fairly robotic. So this is obviously, you know, this is coming. And this has been on the cards for a while. Robotics has been developing at a pace. The problem with robotics has always been the kind of the fine motor movements, that has been the challenge with robotics. They seem to have got that sorted out, and of course with the generative AI behind, with the voice, you know, synthesis, that's already in place. So interesting times ahead. It's certainly going to be a long time before our language learners have one of these in the house to interact with, but it certainly is something that's already here in a way. Okay, right, we do have time for questions. But I think before we launch into the questions, we do have time. We have a good 10 minutes. I'll give you a couple of minutes with the person next to you just to sort of recap what we've looked at. Think about anything that you found particularly interesting or, you know, relevant to your own context and any questions that you might have, and then we'll move into the questions. Okay, so just take a couple of minutes to recap, discuss. Sorry to interrupt you. Probably the most interesting part of the talk, right? You get to talk to each other. We have about sort of 7 minutes left just for some questions. So please hold your hand up. We have the mics here. Oh, no, we're not doing the whole shy thing now. It's the end of the day. I know you have questions. It's AI.
I'm going to ask a question.
Great.
How do you suggest that teachers can stay on top of this? Because it's such a fast-moving area. Things are changing so quickly. Do you have any recommendations for how teachers can keep up?
Well, apart from reading my book. I think it's enough to keep up with the news. A lot of, because now the educational technology that is in the public eye is AI. This is the first time that I think, you know, the whole world has, you know, minds have been focused on a specific technology. So just keeping up with what's happening in the news keeps you abreast of these things. Regulation, for example, is constantly in the news. Bias. There's been a lot about that and how they've tried to redress bias only to make it worse in images. So all of the stuff I think is in the, yeah, you don't need to be too panicky. The book plus, you know, the news, and then you're okay. Yeah, thanks, Matt. I was questioning.
Hi. I was reading this morning an article about how OpenAI is releasing a new feature about a reflective AI, now that it reflects what it's going to say and rethinks about it. And I don't know, why wouldn't be the next generation maybe less biased and started learning from the bias that it currently has? And perhaps it would be something more similar to a teacher in the future. And why would that be? Would you think that would be an issue for
yes.
the
education? You can never know what's coming, right? I wouldn't know. But I think it's useful to understand how generative AI works in a very general sense, right? So I'm not a computer programmer, and I'm not really a tech person at all. I'm a teacher and a trainer. But I do remember when this all came out, and there was that, you know, general hysteria worldwide in November 2022. Do you remember that? The entire world freaked out when ChatGPT was released. And I watched a couple of YouTube videos for dummies of people explaining how it works. What is generative AI? Because AI is not new. When I was at university in the 80s, I shared a house with three other students, all of whom were studying artificial intelligence, which I'd never heard of. So it goes back, and in fact goes back to the 50s and the 60s. It's this new generative AI that's different. And the difference is that it uses these massive amounts of training data that have been scraped off the internet without permission, et cetera, et cetera. So we have the copyright issue, which we haven't talked about. And then what it does is it's trained on this massive amount of data. You have either supervised training or unsupervised training. The supervised training means that you have real people, badly paid, real people in dark back rooms, going through, you know, having conversations with these models and then giving feedback on what's, you know, the feedback. So it gets kind of, the parameters are set for a slightly better interaction with these apps. But the underlying thing that happens here is that it's run by algorithms that are based on prediction. So you'll notice if you do a biography, say, you know, give me a biography of maybe somebody not very famous, the ChatGPT will make up facts. And the reason it makes up facts is because it's using a predictive model. It's not going to the page on Wikipedia about that person. It's using language in a predictive way. So as long as we're stuck in the predictions type model, I don't see how we get closer to human intelligence. There needs to be some kind of paradigm shift within the computing community. I mean, I do follow blogs of people who discuss these things. I don't recommend it. But it does make you aware that sometimes there's a lot of hype in the press, but the actual community who are involved in AI are maybe a little bit more skeptical and less worried about, you know, that the robots will take over. It's not to say that there won't be some other leap in the future, but it's not with predictive, this kind of algorithmic prediction, not at the moment. Talking about reflection, though, is interesting. I don't know if people remember one of the very early programs called ELIZA. You won't remember it. You may have heard of it from the 1960s. It was ELIZA was a psychologist in very simple computing terms who would give kind of psychological advice to patients. And it was a scientist in MIT, I don't remember his name, might have been Seymour Papert, I don't remember. Anyway, what he did was he created the computer program, and you could say, you know, hello, ELIZA, I'm having problems with my son. And then ELIZA, you know, text, green text on a black screen would say, oh, I'm sorry about that. So you're having problems with your son. Tell me more. And then you go, well, he refuses to do the washing up, and I feel like killing him several times a day. Oh, I'm so sorry to hear that he's not doing the washing up. What seems to be the issue with the washing up? The program was basically this reflective model where it just did this kind of reflective listening thing, reflected everything back to you, and you ended up solving your own problems, which is, of course, what psychologists do. So the reflective OpenAI, I haven't tried it. It might do that. But yeah, at the end of the day, at the moment, I think we're still in a job. Let me put it that way. Yeah. Thank you for the question. Do we have time for another one? Yes. Another question. I can't believe you don't have questions about AI. Yeah, there we go. John, can you wait for the mic?
Do you speak in your new book or do you do you recommend in your book or do you speak about teacher-designed AI programs like Magic School and EduAid?
No, I don't. I try not to mention tools because the book was written at the end of 2023, so about a year ago. So no, because these things come and go.
Mm.
But there certainly are, and this was on the cards then, and it's very much on the cards now, that you get specialized AI programs that focus on specific tasks, like producing lesson plans for EFL teachers and so on and so forth. I mean, there's a lot of stuff out there already to help businesses in certain aspects. But no, I try not to mention products, yeah. Mm.
Do you think that we should be training our teachers on these kinds of products or just AI in general?
Yeah, I'd use the free ones. I'd be, as an educational leader, I would be very worried about buying into any of those products. Well, I first of all want to know where's the data coming from, all of that stuff that we've talked about. I don't know how long it's going to be around. I don't think it's needed. I think the general models that are out there are good enough. In my research for the book, I generated several language plans. I mean, I'm a CELTA Delta trainer from years back, so I do know about teacher training. And I used prompts like, you know, create a lesson plan for intermediate learners at, you know, B1 level on the topic of, you know, the effect of Swedish pop music on the music industry, something like that, something really weird. And the lesson plans are all very similar. They have kind of a little introduction, you know, getting learners thinking about the topic. Then you have some input, then you have some discussion, then you pull the language out, then there's some discussion, and then there's a little bit of homework. So they follow a typical communicative language learning lesson that you will find in any course book. So I tried that. I also tried things like create a lesson plan for me using Suggestopedia as a methodology, which is Suggestopedia, sort of music in the background, and it did exactly the same thing. It pulled through some of the tenets of Suggestopedia into a sort of communicative language lesson. They were not bad. Those lessons were, I would say, diploma level, frankly, really quite usable. As a teacher, of course, you'd want to adapt them. So, you know, it's already out there. And I think teachers are using them, which I think is fine. Helps their, you know, time management. Okay, we're exactly on time. Thank you so much. I hope that was useful.